Lakshmi ma'am?
Yes.
We have some questions for you. Dr. Vikram, are you there? Dr. Karthik, are you there? Madam, you explained to us about the GMS score. You explained to us about the GMS score.
Can I go back to my slides? Is that, I think basically GMS score is just a combination of glands, meatus, and the penile bending. So really, we are looking at a combination of the patient characteristics to try and decide which of the patients who've got less risk for complications. And that way we can counsel the patients accordingly. Okay. So if you're particularly trying to choose to do the patients who have got less risk for complications, then definitely that is one option. But otherwise, you know, it's useful to counsel them. I think my slides had shown the actual scores for the various types of configurations. Yes. Yes. So with that, you can easily counsel the patients.
So on the screen we have, is there any role for testosterone or HCG repair? Testosterone cream application?
See, I restrict testosterone injections. Most of the time injections rather than creams, because one cream, we are relying on the patient or the parent to apply on a regular basis for the patient. And they may or may not do it properly. So I have generally preferred, particularly in younger children, to go for a testosterone injections. Only in cases where the penile size is small, and particularly the glands is not well developed for us to be able to give them a good meatus in an appropriate location. So particularly in children who have got, say, 5-alpha reductase deficiency or who've got other VSD features, where the penile size is suboptimal. So those are the situations in which I've gone for testosterone. And as a general rule, for most patients, I am not using hormonal stimulation.
Okay, madam. What would be your recommendation for our magnification when we use our
Think a magnification of 2.5 is probably ideal for this sort of repair. One, because it also helps you to look at the big picture as well as look at the finer details that you're operating on. So definitely I would recommend magnification, and I use 2.5.
Okay, madam. Do you have any preference of suture material for hypospadias? Is it monofilament or is it Vicryl, rapid Vicryl? What would be your choice?
My preferred suture for hypospadias is 6-0 PDS for two reasons. One, because it is monofilament, and also I like the needle size, and the needle is a very sturdy needle. Even though it's a very small and thin needle, it still withstands most of the surgery without bending and breaking. So I prefer to use 6-0 PDS for the urethral repair. For the skin, I generally use Vicryl Rapid.
Okay, ma'am.
If we are going to use Dato's waterproofing, those kind of in-between tissues, if I have to use something, then I would use a Vicryl, which generally is a 5-0. Or in an older child, so in a pre-pubescent adolescent, I would probably go for a 4-0. But generally for the younger kids, I use a 5-0 Vicryl for the soft tissues and Vicryl Rapid for the skin. For the gland stitch, where I'm going to anchor the catheter to the glands, I generally use a 4-0 silk on a round body needle.
Okay, madam.
The other things that I think I have not mentioned is, one, my ideal age for correction of a hypospadias
is about
from 9 months to about 15 months. Generally, I'd like the child to be of about 7 to 8 kilos of weight. So that's what I'm looking at. So by about 9 months, if they are ready for it, then I'd go for surgery by then. Or sometimes, according to whatever age they come to us. Second thing is, I always use a tourniquet for all my operations. And I think I forgot to say that in my presentation, but you may be able to see that that we've used a tourniquet, which is a cut off part of the glove, the base of the glove is cut, and that comes like a ring. And onto that, we thread a portion of an infant feeding tube. So using that as a tourniquet, we do our surgeries. So my tourniquet time at a maximum is about 1 to 1 hour 15 minutes. That's my maximum time for tourniquet. And I generally apply it from the beginning of surgery until the time of the dressing.
Okay.
Can I add a point on this testosterone?
Yes, please.
Yes, Dr. Ramesh.
Yeah.
Yes,
sir. Yeah, yeah. So as Dr. Lakshmi said, I have started using less of testosterone, particularly if the glans is good. If the glans width is more than 14 millimeter already, then there is no need to use a testosterone. But there are children where the glans width is particularly small. So in those children, I give 3 doses of testosterone at the 7th month, 8th month, and 9th month, and leave a gap of 10 and 11th month, and then operate on between 11 and 12 months, something like that. That is my approach for testosterone.
So what is the role of a topical application of testosterone?
Topical application, the problem is the father only has to apply. Mother cannot touch, she'll develop hirsutism, number one. All fathers come back very late. Then the second thing is, we do not know whether that application is actually has happened. And we don't adjust the dose. When we give an injection, we have an ability to administer it ourselves, and then we are sure that it is given. The thing is also, like after a second injection, if the growth is good enough, I don't have to give the third injection. Okay. So this better, no, in that trust we know the parts of actual life.
So do you need to tip about the glans develop, how to develop the glans wings on both sides, how deep and how far laterally do we go?
Lakshmi.
Sir, we have two eminent people there, and it's a pleasure for us to listen to both of you at the same time.
Lakshmi, you want to go? Yeah, yeah. So glans wings, as Dr. Lakshmi pointed out, the important thing when you develop the glans wing is not to take the glans too far. Like she showed a couple of colored points, like
yes,
the green line. You do not keep on incising the glans wing on the urethral plate up to take the meatus to the tip. Because once you take it all the way to the tip, it becomes stenotic. The meatus is not a tip like a hose pipe. It is a ventral organ. The meatus occupies the ventral portion of the glands. So we have to be able to see the meatus from the ventral aspect, but not from the dorsal aspect. That is how the normal anatomy is. So you don't take the incisions too far away. That is an important thing. But the depth of the glands towards that, the glands closure has to be deep enough. Otherwise, the glands do not rotate. It's like a glands tilt. So it is not a simple approximation, but you tilt it. So you tilt the glands and then bring it over the urethroplasty. So that way the glands plane has to be like between the the one tip several people say is when you start making the glands wing, you take the spongiosa extends and then reaches and then it kind of enters into the glands. So that is the plane between the sponges. So the sponges part has to be with the urethra, and the glands has to be with the glands. So like that. So that is the plane.
Yeah. Adam had put up a beautiful slide showing the blue line and the yellow line.
Just one thing I wanted to say when we were talking about hormonal stimulation is a couple of things actually. One is to remember that the amount of testosterone that is given depends upon the child's age and size.
Yes,
so generally speaking, for the younger children, so we are talking about this 1 to 3 year old kids, generally we give testosterone at 25 milligrams. That's about 1/4 of the actual vial. So vial is 1 milligram, 1 ml, which is 100 milligrams. We give only 25 milligrams of that. And we give it once monthly. And as Dr. Ramesh was saying, before every dose, I always recheck to see how much growth is already there. If I'm happy with the growth, then I won't give another dose. And it's very important that once we've given an injection of testosterone, we don't operate in the first month after, we don't operate within 1 month of the last injection. Because if you operate too early, then the patient has got a lot of erections. and thereby more risk to your operation. So whenever you're using injections of testosterone, you wait for at least 1 month so that the peak erection time comes down before you can proceed for surgery.
What is your take on the cardiac correction along with the hypospadias surgery, madam?
See, it depends on what is the level of cordy. That is what I was trying to say.
Yeah.
If the cordy is in the skin and in the dartos, obviously you can do a single agent with that. If the cordy is at the level of the urethral plate, then you have to divide the urethral plate. Then you have to go for a staged repair. If you are, I mean, I'm a proponent for staged repair. I don't use a Duckett's tube. I don't form a perfusion tube as a single stage repair. I prefer to go for a staged repair where the urethral plate is shot. So then I cut the urethral plate, then put in a graft, let it heal for 6 months, and then go for a second stage.
What would be the choice of your graft, madam?
Perfusion skin is my first choice for graft, inner perfusion skin.
Okay.
And where we don't have adequate inner perfusion skin, then I would go for either a labial or a buccal mucosal graft, depending on how much of graft we need. And if there is a possibility, I always try to combine a perfusion with a buccal mucosal graft. So for the more distal penile level, use a perfusion graft. And for the more proximal penile level, go for a buccal graft.
Okay, madam. Can I take a few questions from Dr. Ramesh Babu?
Yeah.
Babu, please, sir?
Yeah, go in. Tell me.
I have one question which says, what is the difference between Leach-Grigoyer and the modified Leach-Grigoyer?
Modified Leach-Grigoyer is taking more care in preserving the neurovascular bundle. The original Leach-Grigoyer re-implantation involved an aggressive mobilization of the distal portion of that muscle around the entire VU junction. Whereas in modified Leach-Grigoyer, you do not dissect it that aggressively. You preserve the neurovascular bundle so that the neurovascular dysfunction following this re-implantation is minimized.
Okay, sir. Sir, there are a lot of patients which we see who have upper tract kinks associated with the refluxes. Mm. So, when you do a re-implant, do we really worry about those upper tract kinks?
No. See, the dilatation and the kinking and all over a period of time as the child grows, it should get corrected automatically. We do not, you know, worry too much about it. Again, if there is an obstructed megaureter with along with the reflux, then you remove that portion of that narrow urethra and you tailor only the portion of that ureter which you are going to re-implant. You do not keep on pulling out like 10 centimeters of ureter and then tailor the entire thing. That is totally not needed.
So that's when we tend to ask like, what is the length of the ureter that is going to be tailored?
So only the portion of that re-implant. So if you are going to re-implant around some 3.5 centimeters or 4 centimeters, do that only. So that way, it is important that you put interrupted sutures for this, because if you keep continuous and then you excise the tip some more, because you have demobilized too much, then the entire tapering will be gone. So you have to put interrupted sutures for this tapering.
Madam?
Yes.
Would you have, in what situations would you have an SPC kept during hypospadias repair?
Very rarely, to be frank with you. I generally use just a urethral catheter. However, probably one situation where we may want to think about an SPC would be if at the end of my surgery, before I've anchored the catheter, and the catheter just slips out, and if the child has got Mullerian remnant, thereby I'm not able to catheterize again. So that is one situation where I might go for an SPC. But even for the more complex repairs, I generally go for only urethral catheter. However, there is one other situation in which I would go for SPC is when at about 1 week post-surgery, that's when I take off the catheters.
Okay.
If the child goes into retention after removal of the catheter, okay, and first of all, when the child goes into retention, it is usually because of pain. So just give 6 baths. And most of the time, the kids will start passing urine.
Okay.
But if at all we have a situation that either the catheter fell out early or the child goes into retention after removal of the catheter, then I prefer to do an SPC rather than trying to repass a urethral catheter.
Okay, madam.
Govind,
always SPC.
Can I add a point to Govind?
Definitely, sir. Please, sir.
I have specific situations where I do SPC.
Yes,
there is a reason for it because I do single stage also. So when I do a single stage repair like a ducket in a proximal hypospadias, I prefer to have an SPC. Then the second indication for an SPC is when I do a second stage following a first stage repair. Like for example, you have done a BMJ first and then you are doing a second stage. So that's a long suture line and I always worry about it. So in that, when I come to remove the catheter, I want to do a trial voiding. So I will do an SPC in that situation. And the third one is adult. Sometimes you get this adult hypospadias. They often fail with the trial voiding because they have difficulty in passing urine. So in these three conditions, I'll leave an SPC. Whereas in regular hypospadias, like your Snodgrass or Matthew or usual distal hypospadias, I do not leave an SPC.
Sir, coming to this long length of suture, particularly in these, if not adults, at least in these adolescent age group,
yes.
What extra precautions do you take?
Now,
like a tunica or a Dartos flap or what other precautions?
Now, I like a tunica vaginalis flap, particularly after a long suture line. When your daughter's flap may not be enough. And also after a second stage repair, your foreskin is gone.
Yes, sir.
So you cannot have a foreskin as a third layer. So you have to do a tunica vaginalis flap. Then the other precaution which I have to tell in an adult or an adolescent is, I leave the catheter longer, like for, 10 to 14 days. Whereas in a child, usually it is 7 to 8 days. In an adolescent or an adult, it is like 14 days usually. And always trial voiding with an SPC for 1 or 2 days because they often have difficulty in passing urine the older they get. And then I want to make sure that they are passing urine comfortably, not leaking into the sides or just dropping. They often come back and say that I passed urine a little bit, but that's not enough. I want them to have a proper stream, proper healing before that. And one more point I want to mention about adults is I often tend to give an extra antibiotics for these adults. They have a slightly higher rate of infection than children. Children very rarely get infected, but adults often get infected. So when you do an adult hypospadias repair, please remember that.
See,
sir,
can I just add something in there?
With pleasure, madam.
When we do on post-pubertal children or for older children,
yes,
it's very important to think about adding medication to reduce the
erection.
So, what I use for that is I use cyproterone, which I start 2 days before surgery and continue for at least 10 days post-surgery.
Okay, madam.
So, for a younger child, early puberty, so maybe around 45, that sort of age, weight, then I would give 3-4, so 75. And for an older child, who say 60 kilos or something like that, I would use 100 milligrams of saproterone 3 times a day for that duration of time. Starting 48 hours before surgery and carrying on for at least 10 days post-operatively. In addition to that, I also give them some diazepam at night so that they have better quality of sleep and also, again, decrease the risk of nocturnal erections. So that's the other thing that I add on in the post-pubertal adolescence.
I add Premarin, 0.6.
Okay. Do we use bladder relaxant, sir, for this?
Usually. If you are using a Foley's catheter, often you do not need it. But if you are anything else like a stent
like
or
infant feeding tube,
you need it because they stimulate the trigone a lot. So you have to add them on oxybutynin.
Sir, for both Dr. Ramesh Baba and for Lakshmi Madam, I have the old controversy coming back. We have a question which says you have a bilateral reflux with raised creatinine. Which one would you prefer? Would you prefer a ureterostomy or a vesicostomy?
What age?
We'll take it as a child below 10 years, like, you know, the age of 4.
Okay, I'll tell you about it. If it is like a newborn, you take it from me, it's a newborn, or like 1 month, 2 month old, I will do a vesicostomy, not a ureterostomy. I will do a vesicostomy. People may do a ureterostomy. That's a different story. You can do a single ureterostomy. You don't have to do bilateral ureterostomy. You can do one side ureterostomy that will decompress both. But I won't do a ureterostomy in this particular situation, because when I come back to do a Cohen's reimplantation, my ureterostomy itself will cause difficulty in mobilizing the ureter. So I will do a vesicostomy, and then at the age of 1 year, I will use the vesicostomy itself to make the bladder incision and then do a proper reimplantation at that time. But anyone above 1 year, I am okay to do a reimplantation. Why should I do a ureterostomy?
Yes, sir.
Lakshmi.
Madam, your take.
I'm not very fond of diversions as such.
Okay, so, madam.
If somebody who presents with bilateral dilated upper tracts and the raised creatinine, one needs to explore what are all the causes for that and what are all the reversible causes for that. Just blindly going ahead for a diversion means that if you're going to do, is the child having a problem because the valves are being fulgurated inadequately, or the valves are being fulgurated properly and the child is having a problem with the bladder? So is it because of high pressures? So we need to try and assess what are all the causes for that raised creatinine. Or it may be that the kidneys are failing per se, and the child, no matter what you do, is heading towards a renal transplant. So I think you need to sort of try and categorize. Or in the child who's going for an early renal failure, the first thing they lose is the renal concentrating ability, and they have a diuretic phase. And the diuretic phase may not be handled well by the bladder. So they may actually need overnight bladder drainage so that they can continue to void in the day and have overnight bladder drainage. So there are a lot of other options. And then you have to look at the pharmacology, whether the child needs to have any alpha blockers to improve the outlet resistance, or the child needs to have bladder relaxants. So the child basically needs urodynamics, needs assessment with MCU, urodynamics, and then to assess what needs to be done rather than just blindly going for a diversion.
Do we have some more questions, Dr. Vikram?
No, I saw because one question there which you have not asked yet. See, there was a question like, why you prefer a Cohen's reimplantation over other reimplantation? There was a question,
sir.
There. Now, it's not that we prefer. If there is a bilateral vesicuric reflex, you are there and you have to deal with both, and Cohen's has got a very good success rate. It is easily trainable, easily doable than the other reimplants, which we hardly ever see. But having said that, I do all kind of reimplantations, and if it is a unilateral reflex, I would rather do not a Cohen. I will do something else like a Lisch-Degoy. And also if it is a duplication system or an obstructed megaureter, I will do a polytunnel leg better, not the Cohen. So my indication for Cohen is bilateral vesicuric reflex, where I can easily deal with it in one sitting in going through the bladder.
Sir, as far as the medical treatment of vesicuric reflex is concerned, up to what age would you give them prophylactic antibiotic therapy?
Now, this is a very controversial topic. I'll tell you why. The role of the continuous antibiotic prophylaxis itself is being questioned. What I mean by that is, in grade 1 to 3 reflux, non-dilating reflux, nowadays the evidence is not to give prophylaxis. You just simply wait. If there is a UTI, you treat it. If there is no UTI, don't give prophylaxis. So we are talking about higher grade reflux, like grade 4 or grade 5 reflux, where you give antibiotic prophylaxis. And then if that fails, then you go for a reimplantation. That is how it works. Now, how long you give antibiotic prophylaxis, that's very difficult. There is no age cutoff. But in general, in the United Kingdom, what we did was, like, when the child is toilet trained, like for example 2.5-3 years old, that's when they get toilet trained. By that time, we just simply stop the antibiotics, and see what happens. We don't have to do a, in the US, it's a little complicated. They do a repeat MCU. They want to make sure that the security reflex is gone. I mean, I have a lot of difficulties in asking for a repeat MCU because it's a quite a traumatic procedure. You just stop the antibiotic and see what happens. If there is no reflux, I mean, if there is no UTI, you don't even have to repeat one. But if they are getting repeat UTI, then you go for an MCU, just look for a VUR. So you just stop it at the age of 2 to 3 years.
Madam?
Yes.
We generally have the rule that we can go up to the age of 5 to give antibiotics and wait. What would be your take on this?
I think, as Dr. Ramesh said, we generally go with when the child is toilet trained.
Yes.
There are two reasons for that. One is, when the child is toilet trained, the bladder has moved from being an automatic bladder, and we assume that the pressures that are building up in the bladder are also more normal. And when that is the situation, it is very likely that the reflux can also resolve because the bladder pressures that is being built up is also normal. The bladder is in a more, behaving in a more responsible manner.
Right.
So those kind of situations, there is also maturity of the VU junction. Thereby, most of these children who are going to have resolution of the reflux, it happens by that age. And there is another important reason for waiting for the toilet training age is because in a child who is not toilet trained, you cannot use change in toileting behavior as a sign to pick up a urinary tract infection. So you never know when the child is voiding. So you don't know. Only with fever, you know the child is having a urine infection. Whereas in a child who is previously toilet trained, you can then say if they develop urgency, frequency, then that is probably an onset of a UTI and it is more easy for you to pick up a urinary tract infection. So putting both of these two things together, we generally wait until the child is reliably toilet trained and we say, okay, this is the time to stop the antibiotic prophylaxis and see what happens. You know, if they get further urinary tract infections over the next 6 months, then you go and do something about it. If it is not there and the post-void residue is minimal, okay, so that is the other thing we'll be watching for in these children. If the post-void residue is minimal, then you know that the bladder is behaving properly, it is emptying properly, and there is no spurious post-void because of the reflux going up and down. So from all aspects, looking at the post-void residue in children who have been toilet trained is useful for us to see what's happening with the reflux.
I'll give you one more situation, Govind.
Yes, sir.
You will have sometimes a child coming to you for the first time at the age of 5 to 6 years with the UTI or scarring, or somebody who has never been picked up. In India particularly, they come at the age of 5 or 6 years with a vesicuretic reflux diagnosed. And in those situations, you don't go starting antibiotic prophylaxis because they've already grown. So you need to re-implant them. So the you know, the age to try the antibiotic prophylaxis is from the prenatal, that antenatal group, up to 3 years. You can see them at 4, 5 to 6 years, you re-implant them.
Okay, sir. So that makes it very clear.
Yeah.
What we'll do is we'll take one last question. I have a question which says, what would be the diameter of the portion of the ureter that's going to go into the bladder in re-implant? How do you, what parameters decide on the diameter of the ureter, like the age,
the
length?
It depends on the age. I mean, if you are doing on a 1 year old or 1.5 year old child, your trigone length itself is like maximum 2.5-3 centimeters. So your diameter is probably something like 7 millimeter or something like that. Whereas if you are talking about a 10 year old boy, then you probably will have a bigger size ureter, like 1 centimeter ureter. Then you can easily get a 4 centimeter tunnel.
Yes, you can
lateralize a little bit the hiatus and then bring the meatus a little bit more to this side. So that way you can get a 4 centimeter tunnel. So, 1:4 is reasonably okay.
Yes.
Dr. Ramesh, can you just tell us about the bladder assessment prior to going for a re-implant? Do you need to consider that?
Yeah, so this role of urodynamics or non-invasive urodynamics like Uroflow and other things. Now, there is a lot of debate about when to do these tests and all. My preference is to take a proper history. I mean, I spend a lot of time asking for whether the child has got a constipation, whether the child has got a frequency, urgency, Then whether there's a holding maneuvers like a Vincent's courtesy, or whether there is any wetting episodes, all these things, if at least one of them is there, then I also look at the MCU carefully. If the bladder is slightly irregular, or if there is some sign of bladder neck, spinning top urethra, or one of those, I mean, these are the real indications for urodynamics. On the other hand, if we have a nice and smooth bladder, there is no history of these kind of abnormalities. You have an antenatal hydronephrosis, for example, with a simple bilateral reflux and a smooth bladder in a male child, that is not a child for a urodynamics. Whereas a female child who is a 4 to 5 year old with a lot of constipation and then holding maneuvers, that is the child for urodynamics.